Hello. Get ready to go on an amazing journey to the fascinating world of dwarf planets. Meet Pluto, Eris, Haumea, Makemake, and Ceres. The famous rocks of our solar system. But be prepared, because reaching these extraordinary wonders is not easy. We will discover the secrets to reaching these incredible gems through challenges and out-of-this-world missions. And guess what? There are even more projects in the future that will allow us to land on these mysterious entities in no time. And remember, the best missions are the ones that go where nobody has gone before. Let's go. The most famous dwarf planets. Before discussing the difficulties of reaching the dwarf planets, let's explore them in more detail. Pluto, once considered the ninth planet in the solar system, was reclassified as a dwarf planet in 2006 by the International Astronomical Union, IAU. It has a peculiar orbit different from the eight major planets, being highly elliptical and inclined. If Pluto were to orbit the Earth instead of the Moon, it would appear significantly smaller, with a diameter of approximately 1,477 miles. Pluto is much smaller than our Moon. Surprisingly, Pluto does have an atmosphere, albeit a tiny and dynamic one composed mostly of nitrogen, with traces of methane and carbon monoxide. It's not capable of supporting life as we know it. Eris. Eris is one of the largest known dwarf planets. Initially, it appeared to be larger than Pluto, leading to a scientific debate that resulted in the IAU's decision to redefine the definition of a planet. Consequently, both Pluto and Eris, along with similar objects, are now categorized as dwarf planets. Eris is slightly smaller than Earth's Moon, with a size comparison of a popcorn kernel to Earth's nickel. Due to its considerable distance from the Sun, Eris is extremely cold, making it highly unlikely for life to exist there. Its atmosphere collapses and freezes, falling to the surface as snow. Haumea. Haumea, unlike other dwarf planets, has an elongated shape rather than a spherical one, believed to be caused by its fast rotation. It's one of the fastest rotating objects in the solar system, intriguing astronomers for a long time. There's a possibility that a massive object impacted Haumea billions of years ago, setting off its spin and creating its moons. Along its orbit around the Sun, Haumea is accompanied by its moons, Namaka and Haiaka, named after Hawaiian mythological figures. Makemake. Makemake is known for its relatively large size and its brightness as a dwarf planet. With its radius of approximately 444 miles, Makemake is about one-ninth the size of Earth. Details of its surface are challenging to distinguish from such a distance, but it appears reddish-brownish, similar to Pluto. Frozen methane and ethane have also been found on its surface. In fact, pellets of frozen methane as big as half an inch in diameter may rest on Makemake's cold surface. Ceres. Last but not least, there's Ceres. In addition to being a dwarf planet, Ceres is also considered a protoplanet because it's large enough to have undergone some differentiation, meaning this celestial body became internally layered with distinct zones or layers of varying composition, density, and physical properties. This usually occurs to the heaviest objects in the solar system, such as planets, as a result of the body's earthly molten state and the subsequent gravitational sorting of materials. Unfortunately, though, Ceres didn't reach full planetary status. Where are they located? Most dwarf planets and many other minor bodies in our solar system are primarily located in the Kuiper Belt. This concentration includes, among others, Pluto, Makemake, and Haumea. This brings up the question, why are most of them found in this particular region? The reason is quite simple. Astronomy tells us that the early formation of our solar system left behind a significant amount of bodies and remnants. The Kuiper Belt, which stretches from about 30 to 55 astronomical units away from the Sun, contains a vast quantity of this leftover material. These remnants come from the protoplanetary disk that gave rise to the major planets. Due to its distance from the Sun, The Kuiper Belt consists mostly of cold objects made of icy substances such as water, methane, and ammonia, along with some rock and metal. This environment provides favorable conditions for the creation of dwarf planets, which can be composed of a mixture of these materials. Essentially, the formation processes of the solar system left behind enough debris to produce the dwarf planets we see today. Another reason is that, beyond the orbit of Neptune, the influence of the major planet's gravity weakens significantly. As a result, smaller bodies can exist without being disturbed by the larger planets, making the Kuiper Belt a stable environment for dwarf planets to persist over long periods. However, it's important to note that while many dwarf planets reside in the Kuiper Belt, not are all exclusively found there. One example is Ceres, which can be found in the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. Another is Eris, which lies in the scattered disk, a distant circumstellar disk that partly overlaps with the Kuiper Belt, but extends much farther away from the Sun and higher above and below the ecliptic than the Kuiper Belt itself. As you can see, the primary challenge in sending a mission to explore dwarf planets is the vast distance they are located from us. No matter which spacecraft is chosen, it must endure a lengthy journey before reaching its intended destination. New Horizons mission to Pluto. In 2006, NASA launched the New Horizons spacecraft on an ambitious mission to explore Pluto. The spacecraft, no bigger than a grand piano, was propelled by a powerful Atlas V rocket. Equipped with state-of-the-art technology and cutting-edge instruments, New Horizons embarked on a journey of nearly a decade, covering an astonishing distance of over 4.9 billion kilometers. Pluto showcased a captivating array of wonders. New Horizons instruments provided crucial data on Pluto's composition, atmosphere, and geology, revealing unexpected icy mountains and intricate atmospheric phenomena. However, reaching Pluto must have been very hard. Ask me why. It's easier to understand if we take a look at the mission analysis. As the countdown began, the mission planners meticulously calculated the launch window, ensuring that the spacecraft's path would align with a specific planetary configuration for an efficient journey. After launch, New Horizons journeyed through the vast expanse of space, propelled by its initial burst of energy and the relentless pull of gravity. A pivotal moment in the mission occurred in February of 2007, when New Horizons approached the gas giant Jupiter. Here, it executed a meticulously planned gravity assist maneuver. This slingshot around Jupiter not only increased the spacecraft's velocity, but also fine-tuned its trajectory, ensuring a precise approach to Pluto. As New Horizons continued its journey through the cosmic void, the navigators and mission planners worked tirelessly to monitor and adjust its trajectory. Precise calculations and meticulous adjustments were made to guarantee the spacecraft's safe passage through the frigid reaches of space. This is not as easy as it sounds. Imagine having to control a spacecraft wandering far away in space. After nearly 10 years of travel, the spacecraft finally reached its destination on July 14, 2015. This marked the ultimate test for the trajectory analysis, as mission operators on Earth carefully guided the spacecraft to pass as close as possible to Pluto, resulting in a wealth of invaluable scientific data. The most challenging aspects of this mission undoubtedly involved executing slingshot maneuvers near Jupiter. These maneuvers were necessary due to the spacecraft's limited nuclear power initially provided. Also, equipping the spacecraft with solar panels would have been futile, as the energy from the Sun would have been extremely weak at such vast distances from the star. Hey, before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can improve it for you, the viewer. Plus, don't forget to subscribe to our channel by making sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. Landing on a dwarf planet. A lot of missions have been sent to the dwarf planets in order to study their geology and composition, as well as their surface features. This is extremely important in view of future space missions aiming to land on the surface of one of these bodies. Indeed, as of today, no mission has successfully landed on a dwarf planet. The challenges of landing on a distant and relatively small celestial body like a dwarf planet are significant. The gravity on these bodies is very weak, which makes it difficult to land and stay anchored. Additionally, the harsh conditions, extremely cold, and the lack of a substantial atmosphere can pose further complications. Plus, we really have very small clues on how these bodies actually are. For instance, before the New Horizons mission, very little was known about the surface and terrain of Pluto. This would have made planning for a safe and successful landing a challenge. Most missions to dwarf planets have opted for flybys or orbits, where the spacecraft conducts observations from a distance or orbits around the dwarf planet to gather data. CALICO mission to Ceres. Scientists and researchers are actively working on the challenge of landing on a dwarf planet, with one such project being the CALICO mission. CALICO, led by the Luleå University of Technology, is a proposal for the European Space Agency, ESA, and aims to land on the dwarf planet Ceres in order to analyze its surface material and activity. But a question naturally arises. Why Ceres? This dwarf planet is actually classified as an ocean world, a type of celestial body in our solar system that either currently has or has had large quantities of liquid water. The scientific interest in ocean worlds has been growing, as it is believed that conditions in these bodies may have been suitable for the existence of life. The potential for life on Ceres is intriguing, as it is believed that the planet may have once had the conditions necessary to support life within its interior. The presence of organic material and an abundance of salts on the surface suggests that Ceres could provide valuable insights into the early stages of the origin of life in our solar system, according to Axel Hagerman, a member of the team. CALICO's mission objective is to land in a specific crater on Ceres called Okater, which is known for its salt-rich deposits. These deposits indicate that brines or saltwater solutions have recently erupted onto the surface. By utilizing advanced instruments from various European research institutes, CALICO aims to analyze the chemistry, mineralogy, geology, and physics of the surface material on Ceres. Additionally, these instruments will enable scientists to identify signs of aqueous activity and potentially discover whether there are liquids below the planet's surface. The data and information gathered by CALICO's instruments will provide valuable insights into the composition and history of Ceres. By understanding the chemistry and geology of this dwarf planet, scientists hope to gain a better understanding of the potential for life within our solar system, particularly during its early stages. Although landing on a dwarf planet remains a formidable challenge, the CALICO mission represents a significant step forward in our exploration of these celestial bodies. The scientific community eagerly awaits to see where this mission will take us. If everything goes well, it could provide valuable insights into the origins and potential for life in our solar system and ultimately on Earth. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching. What's your favorite dwarf planet? Let us know in the comments below. We'll see you next time on the channel.